First of all, today, look at complex conjugates in a little bit more detail. Now, some properties of the complex conjugates. The modulus of the conjugate must be the same as the modulus of the actual complex number itself. Because remember, the only difference between the two was they were reflected in the x-axis. So their distance from the origin has got to be the same. The arguments, however, will be the negative of each other. Again, because of that reflection in the x-axis. Now, ZZ conjugate, thank goodness I don't have to keep saying, oh, it's the sum of two squares anymore, because now there's a much neater way of describing that, is we can simply say, oh, it's the modulus squared. Do you remember the modulus is the square root of x squared plus y squared? And we talked about this before, but just recapping that one, the order that you find the conjugates in doesn't matter. You could add the numbers together first, then find the conjugate, or find the conjugates then add them together. Same with multiplication, same with division. And now the reciprocal, again, there's a neater way of saying it now. We can simply say, oh, well, the reciprocal of a complex number will be the conjugate over the modulus squared. I'm going to play around with conjugates here to prove this idea. I mean, there are other ways of doing it, but let's use conjugates to prove this one. So we're told that x plus iy is the square root of 6 plus 2i and 3 minus I. We're going to show that x squared plus y squared is 2. So, okay, x plus iy, they told me, square root, 6 plus 2i on 3 minus I. If I was to square that, obviously I'll get rid of the square root symbol. But now if I play around with conjugates, the conjugate of x plus iy squared then is the conjugate of the right-hand side, 6 plus 2i and 3 minus I. But now we can use our properties, because we said, well, with division, it didn't matter which order we do it in. So I could rewrite that as conjugate of 6 plus 2i on the conjugate of 3 minus I. And the left-hand side, I could also play around with that one and say, well, the conjugate of x plus iy squared must be the same as the conjugate squared. And so I've changed that to x minus iy. So I now have these two expressions. Remember, we're trying to get an expression for x squared plus y squared. If I was to now multiply the two expressions together, on the left-hand side, we'll get the difference of two squares squared, which of course will become the sum of two squares, which is what we're trying to get. And then on the right-hand side, if you have a look what happens to our fractions, each of them are the conjugates times each other. So the left-hand side will become x squared plus y squared, all squared. The right-hand side will become the difference of two squares, but because we're playing with complex numbers, it becomes the sum of two squares. We'll get 36 plus 4 and 9 plus 1. So x squared plus y squared squared is 4. Therefore, x squared plus y squared must be 2. And it has to be positive 2, because remember, x and y are real numbers. And we square them, they're going to be positive numbers. So it's a way of proving that one. Now, of course, we could have found the square root of all that and then said, what's the real part squared, the imaginary part squared, and hopefully it would end up to be 2 as well. I mean, there's different ways of solving these sorts of problems. So I've pulled an exercise out of the old Patel textbook, which I've copied in the handout for you. And so have a go. That's a bit of playing with conjugates.